1 Corinthians, we read, "If you give thanks with your spirit, how can anyone in the position of an outsider say amen to your thanksgiving when he does not know what you're saying?" That's a little verse that says a lot about this word amen. First of all, it says that amen is biblical. Paul actually expected the Christians in Corinth to say this word. And so, secondly, we see that this word amen, it's not actually Greek. You know, Paul was writing in Greek to a Greek-speaking audience, and yet he threw this Hebrew word in there, amen, which, of course, in Hebrew meant let it be so, or yes, or that's true. And so it is a great word for us to use to respond when we feel that in our spirits. Yes, that's true. Let it be so. So it creates a sense of unity within our church when we hear one another say that and encourages one another. And thirdly, amen, since it was not translated, it was just put in there from the Hebrew into the Greek, other translators into various languages have kept that tradition, which means around the world, if we were sitting in on any church service that was a biblical congregation, we might not recognize a thing of anything that's said if it's in another language, but we would recognize that word amen. This is a word that creates unity globally around the church of Christ as believers gather to say this word in agreement with one another. So get your amen out this morning. Be ready. Let's pray. Father God, this morning we recognize you as the giver of all good gifts and the one who delights in giving good gifts to his children. And so it's with faith and boldness and expectation that we pray this morning that you would give us the greatest possible gift. God, please help us to see Jesus. Help us to see him so that we can become more like him, so that we can love him better. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I've tried in vain a thousand ways, my fears to quell, my hopes to raise, but what I need is ever only Jesus. You died, you live, you reign, you plead. There's love in all your words and deeds. This weary heart finds all it needs in ever only Jesus. To know you, Jesus, my Lord, King of the heavens, King of my soul, I trade my treasure and all my rewards, Jesus, to know you. Some should curse me for your name. I have no fear, I have no shame. You stand with me for all my days, my ever only Jesus. I want to know you, Jesus, my Lord, King of the heavens. Treasure and all my rewards, Jesus, to know you and know you more. Like wave after wave on the ocean, Jesus, my Lord, King of the heavens, King of my soul, I trade my treasure and all my rewards, Jesus, to know victorious, his kingdom knows no end. Through his resurrection, death has lost its hold. I know on that final day, I'll rise as Jesus rose. On that day, we will see you shining brighter than the sun. On that day, we will know you as we lift our voice as one. Till that day, we will praise you for your never-ending grace. And we will keep on singing on that glorious day. Blessed hope, though now tired and worn, we will spend eternity around our Savior's throne. Though we grieve our losses, we grieve not in vain, for we know our crown of glory waits beyond the grave. On that day, see you shining brighter than the sun. On that day, we will know you as we lift our voice as one. Till that day, we will praise you for your never-ending grace, and we will keep on singing on that glorious day. Day it will be, for at home we shining brighter than the sun. On that day, we will know you as we lift our voice as one. Till that day, we will praise you for your never-ending grace. And we will keep on singing on that glorious day. On that day, we will see you shining brighter than the sun. On that day, we will know you as we lift our voice as one. Till that day, we will praise you for your never-ending grace. And we will keep on singing on that glorious day. And we will keep on singing on that glorious day.
You may be seated.
We continue our worship now through giving. And here at Antioch, the way that we give is through the box in the foyer or making our contributions online, making our gifts there. There's directions in the bulletin, the link. As we give, God has not left us without instruction in his word, without principles. And so we've been going through the 33 laws of stewardship. And law number 15, the law of personal initiative. Hebrews 13:16 says, "Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God." Desire comes before duty in giving. We have received from God freely. We should give freely. Take the initiative in giving to the poor and to the cause of Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you. We worship you together as one body this morning, joined to the saints around the world and even to the saints that we long to see on that day, even as we sing. Lord, we praise you for how you have given freely to us what is most precious to you. May we be willing to make such small sacrifices in our own lives, in the way that we share, small in comparison to the greatness of your grace lavished on us freely in your Son, Jesus. We praise you for the cross, that you did not spare your own Son, but gave him for our sins. We praise you for your church, the family that you've given us. We praise you for your Spirit, the Holy Spirit alive, indwelling us, leading our hearts this morning to worship you. May we share with others in love and in helping one another and in sharing the resources that you've given us, even as you have taught us to give. In Jesus' name.
Please join as we sing, "And Can It Be?" You can find it in your hymnal, hymn number 147.
Pain for me.
I said this morning, I'm someday just going to have to preach that song. That's an amazing piece of work. I'm glad that all these decades later, we're still singing it. Well, we, if you'll recall where we are in Mark's gospel, here in chapter 12, and if you orient yourself time-wise, that's Wednesday, right? We're on Wednesday of the week of our Lord's Passion. So on Monday, we saw what's called the triumphal entry. And then on Tuesday, you recall, it came back with the disciples into Jerusalem, and that was the day that Jesus ran the buyers and sellers out of the temple, which the religious leaders had said that the religious leaders Jesus said had turned that into a robber's den. So he chased them out on Tuesday, and then Wednesday, the day we're on today, so far it has been a day of full of confrontation with the religious leaders of Israel. They challenged his authority. By what authority do you do these things and teach these things? He told the parable of the tenants in response and against them. They asked him that test question about paying taxes, trying to trap him. And then, as we saw just last week, they tried to trap him again with a question about the resurrection. Well, this morning, there's another interaction, but it's a little different. This time, we're not interacting between Jesus and a group of religious leaders, but with a single individual, one scribe. A scribe who, like most of the scribes, not all of them, but most of the scribes, he was a part of the party of the Pharisees. Most were. Scribes that are sometimes called lawyers, sometimes called teachers of the law in Scripture. You'll find both of those. They're basically the professional scholars of the religious establishment in Israel. Their job is to interpret and apply the law of Moses, and of course for the Pharisees, also the teachings and regulations of the rabbis. So they're basically professional theologians, which I think sounds like a pretty sweet gig. And this scribe, he comes to Jesus with a question of his own. Let's look at this here in Mark chapter 12. We're going to read verses 28 all the way through 37. And would you please honor this as God's word by standing if you're able as we read it. Mark chapter 12, beginning in verse 28. And one of the scribes came up and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that he answered them well, asked him, "Which commandment is the most important of all?" Jesus answered, "The most important is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength.' The second is this, 'You shall love your neighbor as yourself.' There is no other commandment greater than these." And the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one and there is no other besides him, and to love him with all the heart and with all the understanding and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is much more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." And when Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And after that, no one dared ask him any more questions. And as Jesus taught in the temple, he said, "How can the scribes say that the Christ is the son of David? David himself, in the Holy Spirit, declared, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet.' David himself calls him Lord. So how is he his son?" And the great throng heard him gladly. You may be seated. He begins here, as we consider this issue of the supreme commandment, you wonder, as the scribe asks his question, is it an honest question, or is it another attempted trap? I've read those who would say both ways. In the context, of course, of what's been going on this Wednesday, we kind of expect that this is a trap, right? The religious leaders have been trying to trap Jesus. Remember, they have a twofold aim. They need to get the crowds turned against Jesus, and of course, they also need Rome to view him as a threat so that he can be executed. So we would sort of assume going into this interaction that's what's going on. But you'll notice Mark doesn't exactly paint it that way. He doesn't start with this scribe flattering Jesus, as the previous people this day have. And in fact, he seems to begin with the scribe being genuinely impressed, right? He says, seeing that he had answered them well, he asked him. So we're going to withhold judgment on that question for a moment. Whether it's a test or a genuine question or not, it is a legitimate question, isn't it? It's not a far-fetched question. The scribes had calculated this carefully and described that in the five books of Moses, there were 613 commandments. And naturally, if you've got 613 commandments to, should we say, juggle, you're going to want to know, the question is going to occur to you, which ones should I be most concerned about here, out of all of them? Which ones do I need to take the most seriously or give the most attention to? And of course, the scribes and the rabbis had thought about this carefully. And they'd made divisions within the law, within those 613 commandments. They, first of all, very obviously divided them into the positive commands, do this, and the negative commands, don't do that. And then they'd also further divided them into, they saw a gradation of commandments that were lighter and commandments that were heavier, more serious, you could say. So no doubt all of that is going through the scribe's mind and their various divisions and considerations of the law. Jesus, when he's asked the question, he doesn't hesitate, he doesn't wrestle with it, he doesn't break them down into categories, he gives an immediate answer. He takes him directly to Deuteronomy chapter 6, a very familiar, recited every day for observant Jews, a very familiar passage, and he says the first, the foremost, the most important, the supreme commandment is this: love the one true God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. There's one God. Jesus establishes that he is an Orthodox Jew here. He's a monotheist. There is one God, and you are to love that God. And then he lists basically the same descriptions of, we could say, components of a man as Moses did in Deuteronomy: heart, soul, mind, and strength. The heart, of course, you're familiar at this point in Hebrew thinking, was really the core of who you were, the core of your identity, the center of where your thinking and willing and personality comes from. The soul, as Jesus uses it here, I think is similar to how he uses it in Matthew chapter 26, which is basically as speaking about where we feel. He said in Matthew 26, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me." And then strength, you can figure that one out pretty easily, right? That's your physical ability, your physical function, all of that. And then if you were paying careful attention and you were looking back at Deuteronomy when you listened to Jesus read this, you'll notice that Jesus adds a component that Deuteronomy didn't explicitly mention, although I'm convinced it was implied. He says mind, our faculty of thinking and reasoning. The scribe seems to pick that up and echo it in how he responds, if you notice, the understanding. Now, is the point that you've got to split yourself into these various components and each component must be aligned towards loving the one true God? No, the point is your whole person, right? All of you, whether it's your hands in their work, your mind in its thinking, your heart, your soul, all of it, all of you. And what is all of you supposed to be doing with this, toward this one true God? Obeying him? That's not what the text says. It says love. You could translate that. It means to have a warm regard for and interest in another person, to cherish, to have affection for. A great translation is the word love. Although sometimes in English that's a little messy because we don't have different words for love. We just kind of have the one. They did have more words for that at this point in Greek. And Jesus uses not the love of attraction, but the intentional love, the love of choosing and obedience. Your whole being is to be involved in loving God in that way. I like how John MacArthur put this, genuine love for God is an intelligent love, an emotional love, a willing love, and an active love. In short, it is a comprehensive, all-consuming love and singular adoration. It's not enough to just obey God's commandments. You have to obey him out of an all-encompassing, whole-person love for this one true God. And Jesus says that is the most important, is the supreme commandment. But you notice, the scribe asked what's the most important. Jesus goes him one better. He gives him the most important and, bonus, the second most important. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Do you like that Jesus just assumes that you do love yourself? He doesn't approach this like modern psychology does and say, okay, you need to learn to love yourself, and then when you've got self-love down, then that can spill over onto others. No, no, no. He says, he takes for granted you do love yourself. You, in fact, are the most important person in your world. And so the commandment is, you're going to see to it that you are fed and clothed and have everything you need. The commandment is you must love your neighbor in that same way. And you can understand, as Jesus gives these commandments, why the first one is there, right? I mean, that makes sense, and makes sense why it would be the supreme commandment. Okay, there is one God. He is the creator. He is, in fact, the only being in all of the universe who is worthy of that level of love and devotion. And, in fact, therefore, he ought to have it. It totally makes sense, that first commandment. Why is the second one there? Why is the second one paired up with it? We could spend some time thinking about that, but I think very simply, the way John summarizes this is very helpful. John, in 1 John 4:20, says, if anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. In a very real way, the way you love God with all your heart and soul and mind and strength is through loving your neighbor. Now, there's another thing about those first and second commandments that you probably picked up on as Jesus is talking here. Maybe your mind went back to the two tablets containing the Ten Commandments, and you thought, well, those first four commandments of the ten, what are they about? Loving God. Right, that's what they're all about. And of course, the remaining six, what are they about? Loving your neighbor. That's what the Ten Commandments are about. And so you could say it this way. It's not just that these two commandments are the first and second most important. They are, but it is also the case that all of the other commandments flow from these two. All of the other commandments are summarized in these two. So, is the question that the scribe asks then a good question? I think it is. Is it a legitimate question or is it a test? Well, there we go. Matthew, if you glanced over at his telling of this account, he doesn't seem to think this is a legit question. He says in verse 35 of chapter 22, one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. He seems to ascribe ill motives to the scribe here in asking the question. So you wonder then, okay, is Mark just like a softy or a rube? Did he not pick up on the fact that the scribe was illegitimately asking the question? He was actually seeking to test him. Matthew saw through his charade. Mark didn't. Or Peter didn't, perhaps, as he's watching and then relates it later to Mark. I don't think that's the issue. I think what's more likely is that this actually did start out as a test, like Matthew said, but it ended up for this scribe being a revelation, an epiphany. And here's why I say that. Look down at verse 32. The scribe said to him, you are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one and there is no other besides him, and to love him with all the heart and with all the understanding and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is much more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. Matthew didn't include that part. He included the scribe's question and Jesus' response to the question. He doesn't include the scribe's reaction to Jesus' answer. Mark does. I think that's why he sets it up a little more softly than Matthew did, and that's why I call it an epiphany for this scribe. Think about it. Here are two things to notice. If you've been paying attention through Mark's gospel, you realize this is the only one of the religious leaders who's gotten this, as far as we can tell, right? From what John Mark has told us about them so far, because they're all, from everything we've seen, the religious leaders are focused on outward, external, ritual observance of the law, right? That's their whole thing. And this scribe has penetrated past all that and gotten right to the heart of the law. Jesus had said, you remember, in Luke's gospel, "Woe to you, Pharisees, for you tithe mint and rue and every herb and neglect justice and the love of God. These you ought to have done without neglecting the others." Here's this scribe standing alone on that front. He's got it. And second reason is Jesus calls his answer wise, right? When the scribe responds to Jesus' summary of the most important commandments, verse 34, when Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." I love that. And then whether it's a sincere question or not, it certainly is a turning point in the narrative, isn't it? Because immediately after that, Mark says, after that, no one dared to ask him any more questions. Jesus has been on the defense all day here in these interactions here in the temple courts. But from now on, he's going to go on offense. He's going to start asking the questions, as he does immediately after in verse 35. Verse 35, where we consider the issue of son or Lord. Now, I want to admit that when you first read verse 35 there, coming off of that interaction between Jesus and the scribe, it looks totally disconnected. And in fact, I'll even further admit, Mark does not explicitly connect them together in how he tells this. I think he's leaving that up to us as his readers, and I think we're going to see why they're related. So he says in verse 35, as Jesus taught in the temple, he said, "How can the scribes say that the Christ is the son of David?" And I'm including that seemingly unconnected event right in this same sermon because I think it belongs here, as I'm going to hope to try to show you here. So let's deal with this question. Jesus asks what really seems like, number one, an out of the blue, and number two, a totally academic question, right? He quotes Psalm 110. He says, "How can they say," the scribes, probably including this guy who just asked the question, "how can the scribes say," and of course it's not just the scribes, everyone believes this, "how can they say that the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one, the one who was going to be sent from God as promised, how can they say that he's David's son?" Because Jesus says, "David himself said," and then he quotes from the 110th Psalm, "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." Now, he's quoting a psalm, number 110, that everybody understood, and we certainly would believe today, that's a messianic psalm. It's a psalm speaking about the Messiah, the Christ, who was to come. Now, if you study the Psalms at all, looking at commentaries or so forth on them, you would discover that there is a debate raging in academic circles and has been forever about who the actual author of the 110th Psalm really was, because it's just pretty much universally agreed in modern scholarship that the psalm itself was written much, 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 much after David's time, and so David couldn't have written it, and so who did? Now, Jesus is just clueless about this whole debate here because he seems to think that David wrote it. I mean, what does Jesus know? He doesn't just think that David wrote it. He thinks that David did so in the Holy Spirit. You see that? As David spoke in the Holy Spirit. It's almost like Jesus has the idea of Davidic authorship and the idea that in some way Scripture was like breathed out by God the Spirit, a doctrine of some sort of inspiration. Imagine that. And so Jesus says, David himself in the Holy Spirit declared, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. There are two, if you're looking carefully at that quotation, there are two lords there. If you're looking at his quote there in your New Testament Gospel of Mark, it's quoting from Psalm 10, so you probably have quotation marks around it, and it has two lords. The Lord said to my Lord. And if you want to study that verse to figure out who's who there, it's the same word for Lord, kurios. So a word study isn't going to help you much here to figure out who's who, Lord and Lord. Now, in your Greek New Testament, it is the same word, Lord, Lord. But actually, in the psalm, as originally written in Hebrew, it's not the same word. It's actually two different words. You could literally translate it this way. Yahweh says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies as a footstool for your feet. So it's David is saying, God said to my superior, my Lord. Who's David's superior? Who's David's Lord? Who's going to have his enemies put under his feet? Well, that's obviously the Messiah, right? The Messiah will be the one who has his enemies put under his feet. And David's Lord and his master, his Adonai in the original translation, or in the original Hebrew, his Adonai, his Lord, his master, his superior is this Messiah. Who's going to put the Messiah's enemies under his feet? Yahweh is, right? And so now you see the problem that Jesus is raising with this question, right? David calls the Messiah, who everybody agrees is David's son, David calls him Lord. And they were confused about things in their day differently than we are about things in our day, but everybody would have understood universally at this point in history, not just in Israel, but throughout the ancient world, your kids are lots of things, but they are not your Lord. In fact, if anything, the reverse is true. The father is superior over the son. And so there's no conceivable way for a son to be the Lord of a father, for David's son to be David's Lord, David's superior, David's master. And so now you understand the question. So why is Jesus asking it? It is a difficult question, right? How can David refer to the Messiah as his Lord when he's his son, if he's his son? So there are two ways that you could understand what Jesus is pointing out here. One, Jesus is saying the scribes are wrong, and the Messiah, the Christ, can't be the son of David. He could mean that. Now, we've seen Jesus called son of David, even pretty recently, right? When he was called the son of David by the blind beggar, and then when the crowds were acclaiming him on his way into Jerusalem, he was called the son of David there. I don't remember him correcting anyone. And of course, if he did correct them, and if that is his intention to say the Messiah can't be the son of David, well then, he's going to contradict a lot of the Old Testament. He's even going to contradict Matthew, who in his opening of his gospel, literally the first verse of his gospel, he says, the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. I don't think that's what Jesus is doing. Okay, so what's our other alternative for understanding him here? What's his point if it's not that? His point is that the scribes were wrong. Not wrong about Jesus being the son of David, wrong because they thought that the Messiah would be only the son of David. That's where they were wrong. The Jews believed that the Messiah would save the nation as a nation. They didn't really have a category of this Messiah being a savior of individual souls. And they sure didn't have any belief that the Messiah would be God in human flesh. And so Jesus' question that he asks here is not an academic question, is it? It's pointing out a massive gap in their understanding of who the Messiah is. An all-important gap. Jesus' question is actually an offer of salvation, if you understand it right. And so he called the scribe not far from the kingdom, right? He said, you are not far from the kingdom. And here's how I think those issues are related, how the question about how's the Messiah David's son and the scribe asking about the greatest commandment, I think there's a way that they are connected to each other. Two main ways, really. First, think back to how Jesus answers the question. What's the greatest commandment? He says, he recites the Shema, hear, O Israel, Yahweh is our God. Yahweh is one. There's one God. And then immediately after dealing with this question from the scribe, immediately after reciting that, then he raises this issue of David. The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand. How did David say that? And you remember there are two lords in that quotation from Psalm 110, and one of them is a son of David, and therefore a son of man. And yet, even in Psalm 110, look where he is in that quotation. He's elevated to the right hand of God, right? Yahweh tells the Messiah, sit at my right hand. That's a position of divine power and authority. It's a position, in other words, of deity. And once you see that, Jesus asking, how can David call him Lord? That's like him offering a key that will unlock the kingdom of God. I'm going to quote John MacArthur again. He said, the Old Testament then reveals not only the Messiah, Jesus' humanity as David's son, but also his deity as David's Lord, exalted at the right hand of the Father. Here is the incomprehensible infinite truth that Jesus Christ is both fully God and fully man. Right there. And Jesus teases them with that issue. He doesn't spell it out, but he asks it here. And once you get it, you've got the key. Not recognizing Jesus, the Messiah, for who he was, son of man, son of David, son of God. That's why the scribe was not far from the kingdom. Give the scribe the credit that is due him here, I think. He's done what really nobody else in Mark's gospel has done. He's penetrated right to the very heart of the law. Love God with all your being and love your neighbor as yourself. He gets that. It's way more important than any amount of sacrifices and anything else the law would regulate. He's understood the kind of otherworldly nature of the kingdom of God. Like, at this point, not even really the apostles are getting this level of insight of understanding how to relate in the kingdom. So then, how come Jesus says he's not far instead of saying he's in? Why is he not far? And the reason why is because love the one true God and love your neighbor as yourself, that's the law. It is not the gospel. I can't tell you how many times I've heard well-intentioned, I'm sure, Christians say, the whole message of the gospel is love God and love your neighbor. No, it's not. That's the law. And the law can't save you. The reason knowing the law doesn't save you, keeping the law doesn't save you. Why can't keeping the law save me? Well, there's nothing wrong with the law, but what does the law say? Well, like Jesus summarized here, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength, and you haven't. And you must love your neighbor as you love your own self, and you haven't. But they're required. That's the greatest commandment and the second greatest commandment. And so you see the issue, right? Somebody has to keep the law of God perfectly. And it's not me. It's not you. And somebody needs to pay for your violation, your failure to keep these commandments. And you don't want to. And this scribe gets the law, penetrating insight into the law. is seen in his answer to Jesus. So he's not far from the kingdom. And you know what they say about close. It counts in horseshoes and hand grenades. It does not count in the kingdom of God. He's not far because he doesn't understand. He doesn't understand the issue that's raised by the very next question that Jesus asks. He doesn't understand what Paul told the Galatians. The law isn't your savior, it's your tutor. It is our tutor to lead us to Christ. Therefore, the law has become our tutor unto Christ, so that we may be justified by faith. If your justification is by loving God and loving your neighbor, you are not going to be justified. So I'm going to say again, Jesus' question about the statement in Psalm 110, David saying, "The Lord said to my Lord," that's the key that will unlock the kingdom of God. For this scribe, if he'll listen, for you. Because the question, even though Mark doesn't spell it out here, even though Jesus just asks it as if he's asking a rhetorical or academic question, there's a truth in that question that's greater than any truth in all the universe, that Jesus is the God-man who will take away sin. Father, what a penetrating insight into the law, into your word as expressed by David in this psalm, into the nature of you as God and reality as it exists, all in this little interaction and this question by our infinitely wise Savior. Lord, I pray that your people got a glimpse of who he is this morning. And that if they don't, if anyone here doesn't know him, that they would be gripped by that glimpse and want to come to know David's greater son as their Lord. I ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Let's all stand as we sing our closing song, Jesus Paid It All.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. In me, thine all in all, Jesus made it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left the crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to pay. My garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And when before the throne standing incomplete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain.